Good morning. This is nice morning. I think it's bright and sunshine. Today we have three distinguished speakers: Professor Adrian Little from University of Melbourne, Dr. Muhammad Chatib Basri from Faculty of Economic and Business Universitas Indonesia, and also Professor Dr. Bambang Shergi Laksmono from the Faculty of Social and Political Sciences Universitas Indonesia. So we have. They will present all the papers that they have been shared to you. I hopefully have been said to you all. The first speaker is Professor Adrian Little. He's a professor of political theory at the University of Melbourne in Australia. Since 2007, he has been the head of the School of Social and Political Sciences. His early books include The Politics of Radical Democracy, The Democratic Piety, Complexity, Conflict, and Violence, and also The Democracy and Northern Ireland, Beyond the Liberal Paradigm, and The Politics of Community Theory and Practice. Oh, and there are many also. So. In addition to many journal articles and book chapters, his book, his recent book is Enduring Conflict, Challenging the Signature of Peace and Democracy. For the last few years, he has been working on a collaborative project funded by the Australian Research Council with colleagues at Melbourne, Monash University, and also Exeter University and the University of South Carolina, examining debates on reconciliation and post-conflict transformation in South Africa, Northern Ireland, and Australia. His paper today is The Reconciliation After Recognition Towards a Future-Oriented Account of Indigenous Settler Relations in Australia. Professor Dean Little, the stage is yours.
Thank you very much. I'm just waiting for the PowerPoint presentation. And my microphone is now on. I hope by the time I finish this that Donald Trump hasn't actually managed to win the American election. But I forgive you all for keeping one eye on your mobile phone while I talk. I'm going to talk to you a little bit today about the reconciliation process that has been taking place in Australia for the last 25 years or so. It is a project that I've been working on focused on Australia, but it's very much a comparative project. And my collaborators and I are really interested in how reconciliation processes have played out in other jurisdictions and the examples that we can learn for Australia in that. Okay. So just to explain the project, it's been funded by the Australian Research Council between 2013 and now. And the project's entitled Reconciliation, Recognition and Resistance in South Africa and Northern Ireland, Lessons for Australia. So it is a comparative project looking at the transitions in South Africa and Northern Ireland and what they can tell us about how we can advance reconciliation in the Australian context. The team on the project are three of us from the University of Melbourne. I point in particular to Mark McMillan because he is the co-author of the paper that I'm presenting today. And Mark is an Aboriginal lawyer at the Melbourne Law School. And basically, we've been conducting workshops in South Africa and Northern Ireland holding workshops in Melbourne over the last 3 years. And we've also been interviewing members of the Council for Aboriginal Reconciliation, which ran in Australia in the 1990s. Now, before getting into the detail of the project, I'd just like to start off with a small anecdote, which I will come back to right at the end. And the anecdote relates to an event that we held in Melbourne a few months ago. And it involved Gareth Evans. Now, some of you may know who Gareth Evans is. He's the former Foreign Minister of Australia, and he was a member of my school before becoming the Chancellor of the Australian National University. And Gareth was reflecting on his time leading the peace talks in Cambodia in the early 1990s. And someone asked him the question of whether the indigenous issue in Australia and Australia's failure to deal with it had hindered his impact as an honest broker in Cambodia in the early 1990s. And his answer was no. It was very short, and it was very sweet and to the point. So I'll come back to Gareth's answer towards the end. But basically, his view was that when it came to Australia acting in international conflicts and trying to mediate conflicts, the fact that it hasn't been able to deal with its own indigenous issue wasn't seen as a major hindrance. Okay, let me give you some background before moving on. Well, since 2010 and the election of Julia Gillard as Australian Prime Minister, Australian governments have all been proposing to amend the Australian Constitution so that it recognises the original inhabitants of Australia, that is, Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander peoples. The Gillard government commissioned an expert panel which delivered its report on what the constitutional amendment should look like in 2012. Subsequently, the Liberal Party came to power in 2013, and they decided to send the recommendations of the expert panel to a joint parliamentary select committee for further discussion. While that discussion was taking place, building up to 2015, Prime Minister Tony Abbott began engaging with a variety of, actually quite a small variety of hand-picked Indigenous leaders who he trusted to carry forward the discussion. And then Abbott was subsequently deposed from within his own party by Malcolm Turnbull, the current Prime Minister, in September 2015. Now, what we can see in this period is that even though both of the major political parties agreed that there should be some kind of constitutional recognition of Indigenous people in Australia, there was absolutely no process behind all of this. There were various initiatives which were taking place, which were unconnected to each other, which were taking place in a piecemeal fashion, and which didn't really give a sense that there was a process taking place towards a decided end point. Now, at the same time as this, the government committed $25 million to a public campaign called Recognize. And the Recognize campaign was designed to persuade Australia to vote yes in a referendum on constitutional change. However, this $25 million was going towards a process designed to persuade people to vote yes without us knowing what the actual question was going to be in a referendum. Moreover, there was no way of actually ascertaining whether Aboriginal people wanted constitutional recognition or not. Meanwhile, the government's funding for the main representative body of Aboriginal politics was frozen. To more recent developments, in December 2015, Malcolm Turnbull introduced a referendum council, which again was a body designed to build up to a referendum in May 2017. Subsequently, a range of consultations were held and are still being held across the country with small groups of Aboriginal people. However, this is Aboriginal people only make up 3% of the population in Australia. By our reckoning, the consultation has probably involved somewhere between 5,000 and 10,000 Aboriginal people. So it's a minute number of people who have actually been consulted. And in my state of Victoria, in one such exercise in February last year, the people voted unanimously to reject constitutional recognition. So this was the first clear sign that perhaps Not only was there a problem with the process towards constitutional recognition, but Aboriginal people might not actually want it on the terms in which the government was proposing it. And what came across very clearly in that meeting was that Aboriginal people were more interested in a treaty rather than constitutional recognition. So let me, before I come to the key points of the address, let me just say a little bit about the theory and practice of the project that I'm discussing. First of all, our theoretical framework, which I won't dwell on, but it's broadly agonistic, and it follows the work of various people on the project team, so Andrew Schapp, Paul Muldoon, and myself. And by agonistic, we mean a theoretical framework which focuses on the politics of conflict and examines the existence of conflict, the mechanisms and the processes through which conflict can be managed, negotiated, and transformed. But significantly, we argue conflict does not go away. It does not get resolved. It has to be managed continually. We need to look not only towards events of the past, but managing conflict in the future. And Mark McMillan and I, as I say, wrote this paper. We also have an article just about to come out in the journal Ethnopolitics, and that's called Invisibility and the Politics of Reconciliation in Australia, Keeping Conflict in View. And one of our key concerns in the project is that the Australian government, as we see it, is hoping to brush conflict under the carpet rather than bring it out into the open. So in that article, Mark and I argue that there's been a failure in Australia to understand Indigenous settler relations as conflictual relations. That's not only in terms of the original invasion of Australia, but also the way in which conflictual relations occur in the present and the way they're likely to remain in the future, regardless of what happens in the current process. So when we look at Indigenous Australia now, we can see a range of structural injustices with very high incarceration rates for Aboriginal people, low educational attainment, child removals from Aboriginal parents at record levels, low life expectancy vis-a-vis the non-Indigenous community, and so forth. So these are not things which can just be dealt with by changing the constitution. They require a full range of social and economic policies as well. But because it isn't seen as a conflictual relationship, we argue that these problems do not come to the fore. And this is mainly because one side of the conflict is nearly always invisible. We argue that before 1967, when full citizenship was eventually granted to Aboriginal people, this was mainly due to a failure to include Aboriginal people as legitimate participants in political debate. However, since the 1990s and the emergence of the reconciliation process, we think that non-Indigenous people have actually become invisible participants in a conflictual relationship. And I will expand on that as I go along. But the debate has mainly focused on the relationship between Aboriginal people and the state, rather than on relationships between people, between Aboriginal people and non-Indigenous people. And we think that that failure to see the role of non-Indigenous people is a major problem in the process that's taking place at the moment. So, whilst we do not want to reduce the importance of the legal relationship with the state, we think it's really important to understand political relationships between people as a key part of the reconciliation debate in Australia. And non-Indigenous people, as we see it, have actually been exonerated from engaging in this process. So there's non-recognition of a conflict. There's non-recognition of who the participants in the conflict are. And therefore, there's a lack of understanding of the fact that conflict needs to be managed in the future. Constitutional recognition may play a role in this, but it certainly can't do all the work by itself. And we believe that Aboriginal people are actually becoming the beasts of burden in ensuring that reconciliation comes about, because there's no real onus on non-Indigenous people to do anything at the moment. It's all up to Aboriginal people to say, yes, we are prepared to accept the changes that the government wants to bring about. Part of the problem with this is that the focus in reconciliation in Australia has almost been entirely on the past. It's been a slow acceptance in Australia that the country was indeed invaded, and it took Australia a very long time to accept that the people who lived there before the English invaders came were in fact human beings. So we think it's important that there is a focus on the past, but it's also not sufficient to establish a solid footing for Indigenous settler relations for the future. So there's a real lack of an understanding of what the future might hold. Therefore, if we do get to a referendum on constitutional recognition, and that's looking some way off at the present time, I think May next year is looking rather unlikely, then even if we do get to a referendum, and even if that referendum is successful, I think there is a relationship between Indigenous and non-Indigenous people that still needs to be managed. Therefore, as we see it, there are three main issues that remain to be addressed in shaping the current debate. The first of these, as I've intimated, is that we need to understand Indigenous settler relations as conflictual, and that those conflicts cannot be simply resolved, but need to be managed into the future. Secondly, we argue that the process of reconciliation is not something that's just focused on dealing with the past, but is about ongoing management of these relations into the future. And thirdly, and I think most importantly for the purposes of this paper, we argue that there's a need to understand relationships better. It's not just about relationships between Indigenous and settler, but also we need to engage with the various conflicts between different non-Indigenous parts of Australian society. And we call this the Bernardi question. There's a guy called Corey Bernardi who is a senator in Australia for the state of South Australia, and he's a very outspoken critic of constitutional recognition. And we think there really is a strong onus on non-Indigenous people in Australia to engage with their own constitutional conservatives, like Corey Bernardi, rather than just relying on Indigenous people to do that work for themselves. So let me just say a few words about each of these three key issues which we think need to be addressed, and then I will conclude. So first of all, managing conflictual relations rather than resolving them. Well, firstly, I think that we need to move beyond the sheer focus on historical facts and wrongs done to Indigenous peoples. These are vitally important, of course, but we also need to think about how we change the relationship between Australia's peoples in the future, and we think that's the only way forward. That therefore requires a conversation about how the place of Australia can be shared, how it can be legally shared, politically shared, socially shared, and indeed culturally shared. Part of the problem with the debate as we see it is that it has been conducted in terms of equality, in terms of how to make Aboriginal people equal to non-Indigenous people. We think this is a fundamental misunderstanding of the issue and of what Indigenous people actually want. Indigenous people are highly aware of their own difference, and they want to maintain their difference. They know they are the original owners of the Australian land and that they were forced from it. Therefore, that maintaining that difference becomes fundamental to the demands of Indigenous people rather than the sheer pursuit of legal equality. This difference will not go away and it cannot be resolved, and therefore we think it needs to be better managed. This brings us, secondly, to the role of reconciliation. Well, as I've intimated, reconciliation in Australia, like in so many other parts of the world, is often viewed in terms of accounting for and apologising for the past, rather than an ongoing process. Reconciliation in Australia, similarly, has been almost solely focused on the past and acknowledging wrongdoing on the part of the colonial invaders. But it avoids the structural injustice questions and the impact of the past on the present. It avoids those questions of not just the fact that Aboriginal people are far more likely to be imprisoned than non-Aboriginal people, or that Aboriginal children are much more likely to be removed from their families than non-Indigenous children. It's not just those sheer facts, it's how they came about and how that's related to past injustices that has created structural problems in Australian society that need to be addressed. So the purpose of reconciliation should be a focus on the future, we argue, and that constitutional recognition may play a part in that, but it cannot do it all by itself. And our third point, and again I recognise that this is perhaps the most important point that we want to make in the paper, we think that the way the debate has been construed is solely about how Indigenous people relate to settlers has exempted many contemporary non-Indigenous Australians from any responsibility whatsoever. There's very little focus on how different settler groups relate to each other, how the left engages with constitutional conservatives, for example. Those disagreements are very rarely ventilated between non-Indigenous people. The emphasis is all placed on Aborigines to resist and to explain what is wrong with the current debates, rather than non-Indigenous people taking that responsibility. So we argue that there needs to be a much greater engagement within non-Indigenous Australia to understand the role they have to play in the issue of how to form better relationships in Australia in the future. So let me very quickly conclude. The paper suggests that the debate over constitutional recognition has mistakenly been conducted in terms of equality. However, the opposition to constitutional recognition is also framed in terms of equality. It's about the law treating everyone in the same way. Our contention is that it needs to be conducted in terms of difference, and conflictual difference at that, if we're to really meet the needs of Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people. The Australian Constitution, as it stands, without the amendment, already recognises Indigenous people as legally different. So the debate needs to focus on how that recognition of difference can be better captured by the Constitution. Difference needs to be discussed in a manner that is more focused on ongoing conflictual relationships rather than just the legal status of Aboriginal people. And that requires an emphasis on non-Indigenous people to engage with each other rather than solely viewing the relationship as between themselves and Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people and the state. Let me finish off just by returning to my anecdote at the start about Gareth Evans and the fact that no one had ever said to him in Cambodia that Australia might need to get its own house in order before intervening in other societies. Well, to be honest with you, I don't think the Indigenous issue should preclude Australia from acting as an honest broker overseas. I think it should be willing to act in that role if it is encouraged to do so. But I think it is an act of hubris for Australia not to properly recognise problems at home. I think Australia needs to recognise this issue itself rather than waiting for people to pull it up on its own behaviour. So Australia needs to take more responsibility for taking its Indigenous conflict seriously, whether others demand it or not, if it is to present itself as any kind of example for other societies in the region or around the world. Terima kasih.
Thank you, Adrian. So we will move to the second speaker, Dr. Muhammad Chatib Basri. He was Indonesia's former Minister of Finance and was the chairman of Indonesia's Investment Coordinating Board. He is the chairman of the advisory board of the Mandiri Institute and chairman of the Indonesia Infrastructure and Finance. He is also a member of the World Bank Advisory Council on Gender and Development. He earned his PhD in economics from the Australian National University. And Dr. Basri teaches at the Department of Economics, Universitas Indonesia. He is the Tekianwi visiting professor at the Australian National University, was S. Center's senior fellow at the Harvard Kennedy School, and also Pacific Fellow at the Center on Global Transformation, University of Carolina, San Diego. He co-founded Sierra Eco Research Institute, a Jakarta-based economic consulting firm in 2010, and he was a member of the Asia-Pacific Regional Advisory Group of the IMF. He was also a member of the High-Level Trade Expert Group co-chaired by Jagdish Bhagwati and Peter Sutherland, and he has acted as a consultant for the World Bank, the IMF, the ADB, the USAID, OSAID, OECD, and the UNCTAD. His paper's title is The Fed Tapering Talk, A Short Statement, Long Impact on Indonesia. Dr. Muhammad Chatib Basri, the stage is yours.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chair. A very good morning, friends and colleagues. It is a great pleasure to be here. In my presentation, how much time do I have? It's 20? 30 minutes, thank you very much, Mr. Chair. In my presentation, I would like to present the case study of Indonesia when we had to deal with the taper tantrum in 2013. This paper is sort of like a combination of policy practice and also a theoretical framework. As probably we know, in theory, we know about everything, but nothing works. In practice, it's the opposite. Everything works, but we don't know why. So in this case, both theory and practice are combined. Nothing works, and we don't know why. So let me start with my presentation with giving a background about this fat tapering stock and the impact on the emerging market. The second one is about the question to be addressed, the theoretical framework, and also the empirical studies of it. So let me start. I don't know, I'm not really sure whether all the audience are economists, so let me try to speak in the human language. The problem with economists is they always like to talk in the language that nobody can understand. And the more people confused, the better they are as an economist. So if you look at from these charts, I try to speak in the human language. Up to the second quarter of the 2013, economic growth in Indonesia was considered as the second fastest growing economy among the members of the G20. So if you look at from these charts, basically Indonesia were doing okay up to the second quarter 2013. You know, the fastest growing economy at that time was China. The second one was Indonesia. Yeah. But Chairman Bernanke made a statement on May 23rd, 2013. And his statement was very short. He just said that the committee currently anticipates that it will be appropriate to moderate the monthly pace of purchases later this year. Yeah. So for some of you who doesn't have any background in economics, for handling the global financial crisis back on 2007 to 2008, the Fed introduced a policy. This is unprecedented monetary policy, what we understand as the quantitative easing. The idea was very simple: by purchasing assets from the, you know, from the business, from the people and society, basically the Fed introduced the liquidity injection to the society. So a lot of money will be available, yeah. But with the taper tantrum, basically what Ben Bernanke said, he reversed this quantitative easing. Yeah, so he stopped the purchase of this asset or bond asset. Basically, by doing this, the Fed is introducing a tightening monetary policy, which is tighten the liquidity from the society. And look at what happened to the emerging market, if you look at these charts. Just a few weeks after that, the stock market collapsed in many countries in emerging market. The exchange rate collapsed in many countries. The bond yield increased, including a country like Indonesia. If you recall, in that situation, the rupiah depreciated from around 9,700 to become almost 12,000 at the time. Yeah, and then people started to think that the economy, the Indonesian economy, you know, was back into the possibility of the Asian financial crisis at that time. So market was very panicked because the statement made by the Chairman Bernanke, because the idea was very simple. If the U.S. tightened the monetary policy, it means that the real return from the U.S. will be higher from emerging markets. So the capital will flowing in from the emerging market back into the United States. Yeah. As a result, this is embarrassing, I put my face. As a result, many policymakers from the emerging market, including Indonesia, a sort of like, I'm not saying protested, but we complained to the Fed about their policy that had an impact on the emerging market. So Governor Rajan, Minister Pravin from South Africa, and I myself, you know, we brought this issue at a G20 meeting in Mexico, in Moscow at that time, on July, I forgot, it was on June or July 2013. Basically, our complaint was, if the Fed would like to introduce a monetary policy, it is always better to consider also what will be the impact on other emerging markets. Because when U.S. introduced the quantitative easing, all of a sudden the capital inflow flowing in into the emerging market. But when the U.S. introduced the taper, you know, the end of quantitative easing, and there was a lot of capital outflow from emerging market back to U.S. And, you know, Indonesia was basically were doing okay at the time. But because this policy introduced by the Fed, then the impact was quite significant. So we asked at that time to have a better communication between the emerging market and the Fed. But the response from the Chairman Bernanke at the time, not verbatim, but basically what he said to us, get your house in order. If you got a problem in your economy, this has to do with your own economy. There's nothing to do with the situation in the US. Yeah, I somehow think that probably the argument made by Chairman Bernanke was also has some points. Why is that? Because the question is, why country like Malaysia, like Singapore, like Philippines were not affected by this taper tantrum? Why only country like Indonesia, Brazil, South Africa, Turkey, and India were affected by this? Yeah, so probably the argument made by Bernanke was right. But, you know, after we launched some policies that eventually the IMF, you know, sort of like doing an assessment that since mid-2013, Indonesia has taken significant steps to strengthen policy and reserve buffers. Basically, within 7 months, we were, together with India, we were able to handle this situation. Yeah, and if you look at this, and then there were three, basically Indonesia and India managed to get out of the so-called the fragile five. We managed to get out of the taper tantrum. Then the research question is, why was Indonesia relatively successful in facing the taper tantrum? The second one, what policies were undertaken and why were they chosen? And how is the political economy behind this? This is the thing that I would like to discuss this morning. So the first one, if you look at in this charts, I'll go briefly with this. You know, if you look at from this charts, from 2010, after the US introduced the quantitative easing, then you can see a lot of capital inflow flowing in into emerging market. Yeah, it's a lot of money. I was the chairman of the investment board of Indonesia at the time. Probably I was considered one of the quite successful chairman, not because I was good, simply because I was lucky. Yeah, because the US introduced the quantitative easing, so money flowing out into emerging market, and then when a country like Indonesia. If you look at from this, you know, the foreign direct investment increase, the portfolio investment increase, but there is a cost of it. Because of this increase of the capital inflow, the foreign reserve steadily increase, but as a result, the rupiah appreciated. As you know, economists know, when there is a capital inflow, there is a risk of the overvaluation of the rupiah. When the rupiah overvaluated, then our export product become very expensive, the import product become very cheap, then as a result, we got a problem of the current account deficit. So the current account deficit started to widen in 2011 when the rupiah, you know, appreciated. So this is on the contrary of the perspective of many people that the strong rupiah is good for the economy. The answer is not. The weak rupiah is good for the economy. Because what happened in Indonesia, we suffered from the case of the Dutch disease. Look at this. When the rupiah gets strengthened, it is true that the GDP growth improved, but as a result, the current account deficit widened. Yeah, until we had to do the expenditure switching and expenditure reducing policy. And then, if we cannot blame the Fed policy or the decision made by the Bernanke, by Chairman Bernanke, then the question is, what was the culprit? What was the important variables that affect emerging market when the US announced the taper tantrum that affected the emerging market? So we try to look at some of these variables. If we quote that the GDP growth isn't important, it is not true because, you know, Indonesian GDP growth at that time was around 5.8, was quite strong. But Indonesia affected by this taper tantrum. If we said that fiscal deficit to GDP matters, a country with the high fiscal deficit will be affected, the answer was not true, because the budget deficit for Indonesia was relatively small, was only 1.8% of GDP. If we blame the government debt to GDP as the culprit, which is not true, because the debt to GDP in Indonesia was only 23% of GDP, then the question is, what was the variable that affected, you know, capital outflow from Indonesia? The answer is all the countries which is considered as the fragile five, which is Brazil, Turkey, India, Indonesia, and South Africa, got a problem in the current account deficit, if you look at this. And this is understandable. When you got a problem of the current account deficit, whereas on the capital account, it is financed by the portfolio, when the investor get panicked, what they do, they just basically bring the money back into the United States or advanced country. So what the government should do at that time is addressing the current account deficit. Then this is the conclusion that I mentioned to you earlier. We cannot make a conclusion. Even high reserve was not an important variable. Brazil and India has high reserve but affected by the taper tantrum. Strong GDP growth is not a guarantee, won't be affected. But definitely, if you allow the exchange rate to be appreciated strongly, and if you allow capital inflow coming in into the country, and there is a risk about the vulnerabilities. Then we go to the policy response. This is basically what the government did at the time. Reduce the fiscal deficit by the cutting of the fuel subsidy, by raise the fuel price by 30 to 44%. The central bank tightening the monetary policy by increase the interest rate by 175 basis points. We allow exchange rate to depreciate deliberately, yeah, and prepare the bilateral swap agreement. Why we need that? Because at the time is what? It was not possible for the government to go to the IMF due to the political situation. If the government went to the IMF, then they won't get the political support from domestic because the stigma of the IMF problem, yeah? We introduced the policy what we call the reverse of the Tobin tax. But the Tobin tax is basically if the short-term capital flow, you have to tax. But in the case of the reverse Tobin tax, if the investor would like to stay longer, then we give a tax break. That's what we call the inverse, the reverse of the Tobin tax. And then as a compensation of this tightening monetary policy and also the fiscal the fiscal cut, the government give a cash transfer and a cash for work program, which is basically try to maintain the purchasing power. So this is the impact. If you look at this, this is the fiscal and monetary policies in Fragile 5. This is a budget deficit. Now, what happened after the government introduced this policy? You could see the trade balance improve. The inflation has been under control because we open up import. And then the rupiah, we let the exchange rate, the rupiah, to depreciate. The rupiah, there is a convergence between the non-delivery forward in Singapore with the rate in Indonesia. So there is no speculation anymore. And if you look at this, the current account deficits steadily decline. So let me move into, but there is a cost of it. Because of this policy, the economy is slowing down. It's only grow by 5% at a time, 5.8%. So let me move into the theoretical explanation behind it. The current account deficit basically a reflection of the excess demand. Because if the demand is too strong and your supply cannot meet the demand and you have an excess demand, this need to be fulfilled by asking, you know, for an investment to come or importing goods or services. So there are two choices at a time. The ideal one, you improve the supply side by introducing competitiveness, building infrastructure, cost doing business, etc., you name it, all the good things. But it takes time. If you cannot address the supply side, then the only thing that you can do is you cut the demand side. If you want to cut the demand side, there are several theories available. The first one is we use the standard accounting identity of Keynes, where this current account deficit is a reflection of the saving investment gap and the government budget deficit. If you want to improve current account deficit, what you should do is a very simple one. Either you increase savings or you lower investment. Or you increase tax or you lower the government spending. That's exactly what the government did. By raising the interest rate, we lower the investment. By cutting the fuel subsidy, we lower the government spending. So when we did that, I wasn't really sure whether the theory will work on reality. It was very rare. Yeah, but this case shows that what we learned on the Department of Economics actually work in reality. It's a very rare case because it's most of the case what we learn has nothing to do with what will happen in the reality. Yeah, or we use the Mandel-Fleming expenditure switching, which is if you let the exchange rate to depreciate, then the import goods become more expensive, the export goods become more cheaper, then you improve the current account deficit. Or the first one, the possibility is Ricardian equivalence. Basically, Ricardian equivalence believe that no impact, because people believe if the government cut the government spending now, they will compensate in the future. So using this theoretical framework, we try to, you know, to do the econometric test. I will skip. I believe, you know, I believe many of you probably will not be very interested about these technical things, but we apply the standard procedure of the time series. Yeah, exactly. Like, you know, we test the whether we have the stationarity in the level, in the first difference. We try to look at the optimum lags. We check whether the model is stable or not, doing the co-integration. And here is the model. I'll skip this. This is not a human language, but if anyone will be interested on this, we'll certainly be happy to discuss about it. Yeah. This is the factor error correction model. And here is the result. This is the hypothesis of Granger causality test. It shows that the budget, the BSUS, it's a budget surplus, does not have a cost on the current account deficit, was rejected. It shows that if the government cut the budget deficit, it will improve the current account deficit. Right? If people argue that the Bank Indonesia does not cause the current account deficit, it's not rejected. But if the exchange rate does not cause the current account deficit, it was rejected. So it shows that if you let the exchange rate to depreciate, then it will improve the current account deficit, or the other way around. And here is the cumulative impulse response function. It is very interesting. 2 quarters after the government introduced the fiscal cut, 6 months after we cut the fuel subsidy, as a result, the current account deficit started to become positive. If you look at on the exchange rate, after we let the exchange rate to depreciate in the first one quarter, the current account become worsened. It's getting worsened, and then started to improve. So if probably some of you still remember about what they call the J curve, it shows that the J curve exists in the case of Indonesia, similar to the Bank Indonesia rate. When the government, when the Bank Indonesia raised the interest rate, as a result, the current account deficit deteriorated, and after 5 months, started to become positive. So this is very interesting that the empirical studies using these econometrics supported the theory about the expenditure switching and expenditure reducing policy. The most difficult one is, this is the last part of my presentation, about the political economy story. All of this policy was politically difficult. If you cut the fuel subsidy, there will be an impact on the unemployment, there will be an impact on the, you know, poverty. So how do we have to handle this? One of the most unpopular policy at that time was cash transfer. Many people criticized this policy because the issue is always targeting. If you want to give the money to the poor people, then the question is, how you can target the poor? How do you know the poor? Whether they are poor or not? The government will never be able to identify the poor. So what the government should do, let the poor to identify themselves. So how? This is very important. If you're doing the research on the RCT, the random control trial, this is a very important one. Let the poor identify themselves. But of course, as a policymaker, they will be criticized by many. Why? Because if you give too much money for these poor people, then you withdraw them from the labor market. They become lazy because the support from the government will induce them not to go to the labor market. But if you give the money too small, it won't have an impact to them. So what the government did at that time, we gave a 30% out of below the poverty line. Yeah, in order to give a subsistence level for them, but not high enough to withdraw them from the labor market. That's the first one. The second one, this is very interesting. If you make this process become very easy, then everyone will queue to get the money. But if you make this process become very difficult, you ask the poor people to queue for 5 hours, then only the poor and the near poor will queue for that. Because I believe many of you doesn't want to spend 5 hours only to get 150,000. That's what we call the market selection, to let the poor to identify themselves. So the process was very difficult at the time. Yeah. So by doing this selecting, targeting the market mechanism, we let the poor to identify themselves. So as a result, the compensation was given by the, of course, it's not entirely perfect at that time. The second one is very difficult. The weak rupiah is politically unpopular. Why? Because 60% of our GDP is basically a private consumption. So if you have a strong rupiah, people get a benefit of it. And the one who get a benefit with the strong rupiah was importer and also the domestic economy. Whereas for the exporter, which is only 25% of GDP, this will hit them. So it's not enough, we don't have enough constituent to support for the weak rupiah. Yeah? And the last one, the opening up import. If we increase the fuel price, one thing that we need to do to stabilize the inflation is opening up import, especially for rice, for beef. Why? Because we are a net consumer of beef and rice. So once we opening import, the poor people get a benefit of it, and we can control the inflation. So last but not least, what are the lessons learned? The first one is, every time we talk about capital inflow, then policymakers are always happy. 3 weeks ago, at the Harvard Kennedy School, I had a long discussion with Carmen Reinhardt, and he reminded me one thing. Every time there is an issue of capital inflow, and the policymakers always said a very dangerous word. This time is different. Look at, you know, every time the economy is moving into the right direction, and people always said, this time is different. That's what happened since the 18th century. Every time the capital inflow happened, then the policymaker said, this time is different. But in fact, the capital inflow have an impact on the real appreciation of the exchange rate, which has led to the current account deficit. Yeah, if that's the case, then it's bring the economy into the vulnerability, because at any time there is a possibility of the capital outflow unless people invest on the foreign direct investment on the export-oriented sector. So high current account deficit makes economy become vulnerable if it's funded by the portfolio. In the case of Indonesia, actually, if we do a sort of like retroactive, probably central bank has to raise the interest rate since 2011, and the government should adjust the fuel price since 2010 at that time. We've been very late in adjusting the fuel price only in 2013 and 2014. And then dependency on external financing is very dangerous. So it is really important to sort of like to introduce the financial deepening, yeah, to induce insurance, pension fund, to put more money on the government bonds. And to overcome taper tantrum, consistency on stability is very important, because India and Indonesia choose stability over growth. And exchange rate is important shock absorber. But in the case of Indonesia, it's very difficult, because if once you let the exchange rate to depreciate, people start to think the risk of this Asian financial crisis is back. So how could we handle this issue? As a technocrat, one thing that you should remember, after 6 months, every president will become a normal president. Bad times makes good policy, and good times makes bad policy. So if you want to launch a reform, wait until the economic situation getting worse, then you gain the political power to launch the economic reform. Don't waste the crisis, launch the economic reform when the economic situation is in a bad condition, because the politician will start to listen to you. But on the good time, if you start to introduce reform, they won't listen to you, because the question is, why should I spend my political capital if the economic situation is pretty good? And it is understandable. And last but not least, the communication is very important. I think after we managed the G20 meeting in Moscow, I was very happy, you know, to learn, started from September 2015 at least, every time the Fed make an announcement about the possibility of raising the interest rate, they start to consider what happened in Brexit, what happened in China, before they are making a decision. I stop it here. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Chatib Basri. This is very interesting issues on economics, but we have limited time, so we move to the next speaker, Professor Bambang Shergi Laksmono. Has in 1987 has been an academic staff at the Department of Social Welfare, Faculty of Social and Political Sciences, and Bambang has been an academic and administrator and the person backbone to the development of social work and social welfare in Indonesia. He has been active and pioneered in developing the social welfare study and practical professional competence through various professional educational associations. In the eyes of Professor Bambang, he has struggled to mainstream the idea of that common public good, well-being and social welfare as the mean and outcome of national development and the currently adopted system of democracy. Moreover, being a part of Asia, Indonesia is expected to contribute significantly to strengthen the social and cultural pillar. As an academic, Bambang for so long has served a comprehensive perspective and welfare theory specific and grounded on an Indonesian perspective. The line of thought may go beyond indigenizing social work, but also seeking a broad, integrated approach sensitive to the eco-social sphere and the Asia-Pacific nation. His paper title is The Complexities of Development and Welfare, Agendas for Indonesian Democracy. Professor Bambang, state is yours.
Hi, and very good morning to everyone. I'm very thankful to be invited to this prestigious event and be in a panel with distinguished speakers. Pak Ismandi, terima kasih very on his introduction that I was to be invited. But okay, so my presentation and the topic that I will bring to you is actually very complicated, truly. So as the title itself suggests, It is actually an invitation to all of us, basically to get a broad view of what is going on in the country and really feel confidence about what is kind of the course of changes that is kind of happening around us. So let me just go through on the topic that the things that I will deliver, and hopefully things will be relevant to many of us who represents psychology as well, sociology, social work, social welfare, and public administration. Of course, there are a few flavors of economics and politics as well into the discussion. So again, let me move on. I've been in full curiosity in following the three major trends of change in the country, which namely points to the policies that related to decentralization, democracy, and the ongoing process of globalization in economy, that is the integration of all parts of our economy into the global settings. And I also wanted to say something about democracy in terms that the political leadership in the country and the local government, which do deal directly with people on the ground, whether they do make policies that really touches upon or create the situation that will provide the improvement in human development, basically in education and health. So I will again later on. Raise a few highlights of some studies that been provided to that enables us to really kind of understand what's going on. Okay. Some of the concern also relates to the reviews that people would say in times of open public discussion, in open politics, there will be some retrenchment, that is the reduction of spending in social sectors. There will be contestation of ideas that the market would probably would induce curtailment, that is reduction of social spending, because we would like to see the market prosper and put probably more incentive for them to grow and create prosperity. But I would like to share later on that maybe on the contrary, but also the fact that is being kind of general facts that governments in democracy do spend a lot on social spending. So in my own kind of interest on social welfare, we would like to see how things are moving in terms of social spending and policies. I will later on also speak about extractive economics if things are possible, time limits, and also the future of democracy in Indonesia. Now, I would like to say something about comprehending Indonesia that is particularly calling upon us on whether we are all of confidence in looking through what is happening in terms of looking into the challenge, not just to understand, but to immerse and consciously direct the course of change and realization of national potentials. Now, I think the idea would be generally calling upon us on understanding democracy itself. I guess one of the problem is that things are in a way imposing us. Since 1998, the age of the introduction of the parliamentary, the new parliamentary, the election system and everything, it's kind of bringing new ideas, and we all are adapting to the situation, whether not whether, but in terms that we are adapting the new system of electing leaders. So I'm trying to point out that the idea of contestation, as Dahl has kind of proposed in the basic readings of the politics, that whether we are coming with good propositions, policies, ideas that will make strategic policies towards the improvement of the living condition of our people. Okay, basically, I did something to make things simple, that if we have a typical situation where we are meeting people on a village level, on a society, community level, they are organizing on the basis of their norms, ecosystem, and organization. The new things that comes around is the idea of globalization, decentralization, democracy, as I mentioned earlier. I did mention this to say that new ideas comes in and people adapt to that. But of course, these things will require systems to work through all the ideas. Now, as we move on to globalization, things of the economy have opened up. Democracy will require a system that will lead us to legitimacy. But of course, the thing is important that we will require not just legitimacy, but the efficiency and the effectiveness of the government and its auditability. Okay? So simply, just want to say that our traditional society have to accomplish all these very difficult new things to become modern, accountable way of managing development. Now, ladies and gentlemen, my friends, I think we come to some question related to whether democracy will work. And we would like to question, like, whether we will have this dividend of democracy, where we'll have trickle-down effects. These are the common question that comes to us. But I will later on see, these difficult realities about the three transformation that undergo in the country right now. The pemekaran itself, the weak divided democracy and development discontinuity, basically wish to tell us that these things are moving on quite fragile. The pemekaran, as many people have already been following, is actually the occasion where local government multiply themselves. And this brings the question whether they are all ready to actually manage public administration and be able to provide things. So on the point of the democracy itself, it's expensive, fragile coalition, weak political party, and depolarization that brings to us to the situation where people are all divided among the lines of figures, ideas, and also kind of sometimes on ethic grounds. Okay, extractive industries and the areas of economy that have relations to investments positively and also the impact on the local community. Okay, I will skip to this, but maybe I will try to focus on this in highlighting the different kind of patterns local government has taken in ways that they do, and they do in terms of policies regarding friendliness. This is the parts that I took from the IGI, the Indonesian Governance Report Index 2012, that when combined among investment indicators, environmental friendly capacity among the local government and their education spending, we will see differences in patterns. There are numbers of provinces in the country that kind of have a volatile pattern. When first they have really an open policies towards investment, the kinds of policies or perda that they have within their own provinces, then when matched to the environmental protection policies, they will have a drop in the scores. So I would just want to say that several provinces have kind of a volatile, so there are good indicators within the investment, and but have bad protection in the environment, but they will then go up having good indicators in education. Other provinces reveals different patterns. Some will have sort of a less friendly investment policies, but will have a very good protection policies for the environment and a variation of the terms that they do on the expenditure for education. Now, some provinces like Central Kalimantan, Bali, have good investment climate, positive one, environment protection, which is good, and education, likewise, which is very good. Other provinces, investment climate scores very low, investment low, environment protection quite low, and education low, not Maluku and Bengkulu. So I guess my own note on this is that local governments have different policies, ways that they organize and priority in terms of how they would deal with development. Now, the point rather, I think important to recognize is that within the sphere of realistic politics in the local government, it should be underlined, it will be needed to have a strong technocratic and planning capacity for the local government to run development within the, not say difficult, but the dynamics of the local politics within the local government. So unless there is a breakthrough for consistent and sustainable planning in the regions that are supported by all the area of governance, Indonesia will lose its golden moment. To facilitate the progress in the regions, leaders, including cadres of political parties, should have genuine goodwill in making the implementation of evidence-based long-term planning. So again, we would like to see whether our democracy has led to us to bring progress and achieve living improvement and stability to induce inclusive development. This is what I did mention earlier about how governments in politics would decide anything that will suit to the call of the public and the voters. And there's a tendency in general that governments do take a stand where they will spend more on social sectors. This will include big decisions on the subsidies, on social spending, basic provisions, and major investment in industry that creates forms of externalities that made that relates to some unintentional impacts on the local on the local people. Okay, bye. I think this has been said already. democracy rules have in fact considered a lot to the interests of the wider and cooperating social interest group by way of making more spending on social sectors. This is the data that I get from the Ministry of Social Affairs from in the year of 2016, which describes the constant increase and quite staggering amount of money being put into the to different categories of people in need, the social services. This is in 2016, projected to be increasing to the amount which is quite significant. Although Indonesia still comparatively not in a position where universality in terms of social services being described in many other countries in comparison to Brazil, Colombia, Mexico, and the Philippines. Indonesia, although have quite big significant increase in social spending, but it is does not still lags behind of the different countries. Okay, if time limits, I also did want to mention a few things related to the government of Jokowi, and it seems to be by the public, we understand that it's much more touching upon the interests of the ones left behind. It did say in the Nawacita to signify on regional development and people of the fringes of the living in the border areas and the isolated islands. There has been an increase in a lot of categories of subsidies of spending in different areas, including the health and education, which all signify signifies the our understanding that have been a lot of spending on social sectors. Now, these are all the pictures that is shown on the public, and we can follow what has been the kind of communication that has been carried on. And also moving through the areas where the digital economy has provided us with more opportunities open up in the global system. Okay, but I would mention if things are being organized through the central government, the earlier diagram I shown earlier about the local government suggests that it's both the local government and the central government have to work together and try to find ways of getting things through along some momentum of policies. But basically would say that we will have to go through with the local government also so that they can also being in full capacity. It's all about potential and also emerging risk related to the different kinds of investment, particularly the ones that have relations to the nature of the mining sectors, the plantation. And I did want to say a few things that democracy and technocracy should be a combined force of transformation, because I think we understand that politics itself are very pragmatic. Somehow we lose sight of the capacity of the planners themselves. Things become very pragmatic and does not become very long-term. Many of the policies are very short-term. Now, I would like to end my presentation just to highlight a quotation raised by Acemoglu and Robinson, saying that quite reflective in a way, and be relevant to the Indonesian situation, when he says that nation fails when they have extractive economic institutions. And in many cases, the economic institution will be the homegrown for a extractive political institution as well, so supported by extractive political institution. And this will, in the long term, will even block the economic growth of the local. The statement was made out of several observation, particularly on rich resource countries in the past colonial regions, and as well as the newly dependent countries. One of the particular case that made reference was on the country in Africa, was on Sierra Leone, and where the country was blessed with, you know, ample of natural resources, gold and diamond. But basically, things when are developed on the basis of a very quick, you know, instant resource that is being exploited, there are not enough time for institutions to consolidate itself politically or in terms of the public administration. So things are moving in a very consumptive way. It does not mature itself to be able to bring forward a good, accountable government. And I think I did want to mention a few things from the IGI report that I earlier quoted. Many of the provinces that shows good marks on their governance rankings are relatively provinces that have been quite developed, long way, and less rely on the natural resources. I might be wrong, but it seems to be on a general observation, Jawa Timur, Yogyakarta, Bali, probably Jambi is questionable, but some of these yellow provinces have less indicators that they rely on the extractions of the natural resources. Where else there are provinces which show relatively lower scores in the governance ranks, have much more reliance on what we might refer to be on the extraction or the resource that have been much more exploited to support the economy of the local government. So I think my overall kind of conclusion would be, first, local government and the national government will have to really kind of find ways of communicating and way of harmonizing the policies. And secondly, the capacity of the local government themselves. And I did also mention a few things related to our concern about social expenditure, that we would like to see more of the governments that they will put priority on the, not just on the natural resources, but also the human resource development. Okay, I did want to refer to one question that was raised in Bali last 2 weeks in a conference. One of our presenter was asked by a participant from Afghanistan, and he was asking the Indonesian colleague who was presenting on the issue of the maternal health the maternal mortality in Indonesia. He said that while in Afghanistan we have civil wars, it's obviously that we have high, you know, score, high figures in the rate of mortal infant and maternal mortality. So he was asking this question to us, and I was really trying to find ways to answer this question. And why in a typically naturally resource-rich Indonesia, the rate of maternal mortality is probably as high as the one in Afghanistan? So I think this was one, the platform of the whole arguments that I want to make. So I think there's a lot of things that we really have to work upon. The kind of local governance, policies, spendings, and the way that we manage investment, environmental protection, and also the way that we kind of put priority in investing in people through health and education. Through the data, the IGI report that I just now proposed and I showed on the power on the slides, that there are variation in the awareness of local government. They are able to kind of make the right mix of policies regarding investment in protecting the environment, and also providing ample and enough of priority in social investment. So I think that's this about all. Hopefully things are quite being able to be followed. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Bambang. I want to ask the floor, is it possible to, if we extend until 10 past 12 for question and answer? Okay. So, if there are no one answered yes, so it means yes. So, I open for three questions. Please state your name first and institution. Okay. The gentleman over there. Pak Turo and the gentleman over there. The gentleman first. Yeah. The mic.
Thank you very much. This is a good for opportunity for me to, you know, get a response for the distinguished
speaker.
Please
state your name and institute.
My name is Kumar Jaya from Department of Economics. I just probably two questions or even three. One question is cross check to gentleman over there is, I think a lot of discussion on the increasing of Gini index. 41. I wonder this a kind of okay or it's a very bad indication or probably worse. I want to cross-check with Bambang, Dede, and a colleague from Australia. This one is just on Gini index. The second one is on my WhatsApp group giving a signal of the Trump will be win. they need Trump front is need a kind of 30 something district, and that's going to be win. And Hillary need a kind of 70. My question to Pak Dede especially, is there any going to be change in global economic environment or and how the impact for Indonesia? And the third one is again for Pak Bambang on welfare issues. With the, I think it's a good sign of spending for welfare. Although my question, my first question is still asking you about the Gini index. What is the what is Uang Kedesa? Is any good result or not? Because I think I'd like to have your view on this, because in December there will be a meeting again in UGM on some of my colleague looking more on decentralization. Terima kasih, Pak.
Thank you. Pak Turo.
Thank Thank you. My name is Dorong Karan. I'm from Lembaga Demografi Fakultas Economy and Business. My question is for Pak Adrian. Is there or how big is the influence of outside force, especially the Pacific Islander group? Because I lived in Hawaii almost 2 decades. The Hawaiian, the Kanaka Maoli, the native, they actually associated themselves with the Pacific Islander. And I heard that the Pacific Islander group also tried to quote-unquote seduce the Papuan, telling they don't actually belong to the Asia country. They actually belong to the Pacific Islander group. So how far is it their influence actually making into the policy in the Australian government? Thank you.
Okay, the next one.
Thank you very much. My name is Suryadi from Faculty of Economics. My question is for Pak Bambang Shergi. I would like to hear your comment regarding, in line with Pak Komar's question, regarding the latest development about the fund to the villages, Dana Desa, regulated by law on villages. Is it really needed to increase the social, economic, cultural capacity of those villages, or is it a kind of short-lived, politically motivated policies that can create more conflict on the villages? Thank you very much.
Okay, I think Pak Bambang first. Yeah. Okay.
May I take the opportunity to answer both questions? Regarding inequality measures, of course, these are very interesting angle that we would like to see. The fact that there is a lot flow of government spending to in terms of all using social assistance measures definitely will impact on the capacity of families, the segments, the vulnerable groups that has been targeted as the groups that is eligible. This will definitely kind of favorable for them. But on the question on inequality themselves, there are, of course, there are different, again, development variables related to that. When regions open up their economy through the measures that I mentioned just now about the openness of local governments toward investment and the capacity for them to protect the environment themselves, these things, these two things, investment and environmental situation, does in a way determine the quality of living of people. People might get marginalized. People might experience severe reduction in the quality of the environment through the investment and the expansion of capital and technology. In many ways, positive. There are, of course, there's people who are become the victims. But in terms of the question was about equality them itself. In many way that we look at this stage, inequality still is the incidence is rising. We will have to produce facts on that. But in terms of getting below 0.4 is a very difficult thing to do right now. But very interestingly, many governments have become more populist in a way that they do spend much more. Then this will then answer the second question, whether it is politically motivated in terms of ways that they will find corridors of spending and reaching to the constituents through the Dana Desa or many forms of social assistance, the PKH, every kind of forms of social assistance. So we kind of looking at the situation where it might be favorable for the poor, but actually it is taking more benefit by the so-called the middle class and those who are able to participate more in the growth economy, the rapid growth of the economy through the opening up the economy.
Dr. Bahati, Basri.
Thank you. Pak Komara, about the Gini coefficient, I think, well, if there is no rule of thumb whether this 0.4.2 or, you know, is would be much more dangerous than 0.1, yeah. You don't know yet, but I think we have been seeing that the tendency about the rising of inequality, especially since the year of 2002. One thing that I would like to respond to you, I think the question is why this happened. In my view, this has to do with two things. The first one is this has to do with the commodity boom. But this commodity boom provided an income of the small group of people, the enclave one. If you look at, just a very simple one, if you look at the top 20, 30 richest on Indonesia, in Indonesia in the Forbes magazine, basically their business are in natural resources, either palm oil, coal, or natural resources, basically. So the employment impact of these natural resources is relatively small. So not much people, you know, gain income from this. And that's one of the possible explanation why this rising inequality has been happening in Indonesia. That's what I'm afraid. In the last 2 years, the Gini coefficient dropped quite significantly because the commodity price collapsed. And if you look at the composition of this group of people, the one that hit the most was basically the middle upper, and not much improvement from the lowest one. Why? Because the richest get hit because this collapse of commodity prices. Some improvement of the middle class. Yeah. So my concern is the improvement of the Gini coefficient in the last 2 years has less to do with the government policy, but simply because the collapse of commodity prices. Because if you look at on the poorest one, not much improvement on the purchasing power. That's the first one. The second one, this is the thing that I'm also concerned about. In 2003, we introduced a policy. This policy was very noble. The idea was to protect the workers by introducing the labor law. And this labor law worked like, because you know, under the new labor law, if you want to do the downsizing, you have to pay about 24 months for the severance payment. Indonesia is a country with the highest severance payment in the world. This act like a hiring tax. As a result, investor doesn't want to go into the labor intensive sector and they go into capital intensive. As a result, the return from the capital intensive sector is much higher than the labor intensive. Then this pushes the growing inequality. So my concern is when we design a policy, the idea was noble, but the impact probably could not be good for the poor people themselves because it could push the, you know, the inequality. For your second question about this, I'll address the Dana Desa later on, about Trump. We don't know yet, Pak, but one thing that especially in financial sector, we understand about one of the concept. We took it from this idea from the psychology, actually, what we call the animal spirits. Yeah, the animal spirits, basically, if people get panic, especially crowd, if they want to avoid the risk, they tend to follow the movement of the mate by the group of people rather than themselves in order to become the risk averter. So if you look at the analysis made on the Donald Trump, basically most of the people said that if Donald Trump will become a president of the United States, then the financial sector will collapse. my take on this is, this is going to be a self-fulfilling prophecy because people believe that. When this happens, then in the short term, there will be a collapse in the financial sector. I could imagine. On the trade channel, probably in the short term, US will become more protectionist. But I have a different view for the medium and the longer term because I believe every president after 1 year will become a normal president. Yeah, all the statement made during the campaign won't last after 1 year. This happened in many countries all over the world. When he or she has to find, has to face the reality, then they become very rational. So let me give an example. For example, Trump would like to build a wall towards Mexico. This will have an impact that the wages in the United States will increase. At the end of the day, will reduce the competitiveness of the United States economy, of the US economy. And Trump, he's a business people. At the end of the day, he doesn't want to, you know, get, won't be re-elected because of this. So probably after 2 years, no difference between him and Clinton. Yeah, but the problem is, after he adjusts to become a normal president, then the financial sector will continue to collapse. And this is enough, you know, to kill the world in 6 months. Because this sort of like the self-fulfilling prophecy. On the Dana Desa, let me give my take on this. I think I'm supporting about this idea of Dana Desa, but I think the most important one is about the implementing this Dana Desa, about the transition. Yeah, one thing that we learn from the process of this the village fund, also the social assistance funds or the so-called BOS, many teachers are not ready to administer this social assistance fund. They end up in prison because they don't know how to do to manage this money. And this happened also to the Dana Desa because many head of villages, they don't understand about the governance. Once all of a sudden they get a 1 billion rupiah and they have to manage the money. And they don't know that, they don't understand about the governance, they have to be audited by the BPK. Yeah. So when they become the risk averse, what they do actually, they don't want to spend the money. And that's happened in the last 2 years. Even though the government already allocated money and nobody would like to spend because they become a risk averse. In the past, why the program on the villages was pretty good? Because it came under the so-called the PNPM, the People's Environment Program, which is basically administered by the central government of Minister of Public Works. So my suggestion is, let's train the head of villages first. Once they get ready, then you started to transfer this village fund from the central government into the local government. Otherwise, they don't work, they don't dare to spend the money. And this money, you know, will sit in the villages and nobody would like to spend it. Especially if one day they will end up in prison simply because, you know, some administrative wrongdoing.
I'll try and answer your question very quickly. It's about the outside forces and influence on Australian debates and Indigenous people. The short answer is there have been very, very few outside influences on the Australian debates. I think the reasons for that, very briefly, there's four of them. One, you know, it's less than 3% of the Australian population, so the debate about Indigenous affairs is really lacking visibility. It was hardly mentioned in the election campaign in June this year. Both parties agree on it, so it's not something where there's where they can, you know, kind of split the vote. So there's a visibility problem. Secondly, it's non-violent. So the fact that there aren't you know, groups or organizations carrying out violent attacks reduces the urgency with which the issue tends to be treated. Thirdly, related to number two, there's very little international pressure on Australia to do anything about it. So in our comparator countries, in Northern Ireland, the United States was in it up to its neck because there's such a big Irish-American vote. And in South Africa, of course, apartheid was such a terrible system that there was enormous pressure and the boycotts and so forth that the apartheid brought on. So there's huge international pressure in those other areas that just doesn't exist in Australia. And the last thing I would say, the fourth reason, is that Australian Aboriginal politics is quite divided. You know, there's not one thing called an Aborigine. There are a load of Indigenous nations, many, many language groups. They don't have one settled agenda. And up until now, they've tended to focus on their internal debates and as an internal problem in Australia. And I think what we find during the project is that most of the Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islanders that we've spoken to really welcome the comparisons that we have brought in through the project, because by and large they just weren't aware of them beforehand.
I'd like to mention something about Papua that was mentioned, was raised, and whether our friends, our citizens of Papua, of Irian Jaya, to be part of the identity within the Pacific community of the Melanesian groups. So this has been quite a discussion, of course, within Indonesia ourselves. Of course, they can be the Melanesian Indonesian, just as well as we are, you know, the Chinese Indonesian. And partly to the fact that the biggest population among the Melanesian stocks lives in the island of the West Papua and also New Guinea. So we have many reasons, of course, historically, and as well as for our nationhood and, you know, argumentation, that we would like to see that the whole issue of the Melanesian group is part of a national identity of the Indonesian Bhinneka Tunggal Ika, as was being delivered and was bring to us by our independence and the process of the political integration, so-called integration in 1969. Of course, there are flaws in development, and people are crying for, you know, justice on the side of development equality, cultural equality, of human rights plights. But again, this is a very quite acceptably, and we have to be very acknowledgeable among Indonesians that we have not been providing a good frame of getting the colleagues, our citizens of Papua, integrated into our national identity, politics, and culture. So again, I guess probably in short, this is our struggle to be making our argumentation both politically and culturally, that our Melanesian group, along with the Melanesian which are existing in the Maluku, in Lombok, in the East Nusa Tenggara, as one big whole identity of one Indonesia nationhood. But this is a long struggle for us to work on.
Thank you. Actually, it will be intriguing also discussion about the Papua issues in it. But since it's now 20 past 12, so maybe we can give a big applause for the three distinguished speakers, Professor Adrian Lita, Dr. Muhammad Khadir Basri, and also Professor Bambang Laksmono.